Catherine Greaves, you just got an Emmy nomination for music supervision for Baby Reindeer. This is your second one. Your first one was for Killing Eve. How does it feel the second time around?
It's very exciting. And yeah, I feel kind of very honored to have been part of such an incredible show. I was nominated before for Killing Eve, but it was during lockdown. So I'm even more excited to actually be able to fly to LA and actually go rather than watching it on
I know, you don't
YouTube.
have to deal with the
On the corner.
pandemics over Zoom.
Yeah, so yeah, far more exciting this time. And yeah, it's been such a kind of journey, I think, and the reception of this show, has been amazing. So yeah, it's very exciting.
Yeah, for sure. So when did you come on board Baby Reindeer? Were you on board before production even started, or did you come on later on, like after it was before?
Before we started shooting, which was quite a long time ago now. I think it was a solid kind of 2 years from that moment to us wrapping the show. Our post got extended for various reasons, and so yeah, it's kind of been bubbling away in my life for a while. There were a couple of moments in the show where Martha quotes lyrics. I think there's the whole scene where she sings something stupid to Donnie, and there are a couple of scenes where Donnie then changes the lyric to refer to Hitler. So I had to to make sure that we got the rights to do that and change the lyric and have that reference. And luckily, we were able to get the clearance. And then there's a second duet in another. Well, I think it was originally scripted as Cher, but we had to change that for budget reasons. So I think I suggested Kylie and Jason. So we had to kind of those were my kind of early inputs on the music for the show. Which was obviously important before they
Yeah,
started
if
filming.
they're singing something, you gotta clear it, or you need
Yeah.
to pick a different song.
It would have been tricky if we'd got denied afterwards. So yeah. I'm normally brought on right from the beginning, and then but most of the work all happens in post-production. So yeah.
I love like all the music in the show because it's such an eclectic mix of like classic rock and like 60s, 70s joints, and then you have some, a more contemporary pop tunes too. So I'm wondering like how many songs were like scripted that Richard already had in mind, and just what were your discussions like in general when you came on board?
There were a couple of songs that were scripted. I think, I've never worked on anything which is so one person. So Richard, it's a true story. He's written it, he's starring in it, he's the producer on it. So, it's really his kind of overall vision and supporting that. And so he's a very kind of big music fan. He's very into certain genres, and he had scripted a couple of songs. So I think Dusty Springfield was scripted, and Angel of the Morning was scripted. So that kind of gave us a rough starting point, I think, to kind of jump off from. And I think there's something that really was quite interesting in those choices, because there's a real kind of innocence to them, and this show is so dark and deals with so many issues that having these kind of quite innocent lights, love songs from the 60s and 70s was a really kind of good place to start. And we kind of developed from that, really, and we used that as a kind of starting point and then kind of built around that. And so, starting off kind of keeping in the 60s and 70s when we first started looking at options, and then that obviously develops and becomes more contemporary in certain points, but all kind of rooted in that sound, I think, was always the kind of the intention. And I think it's always helpful to have some kind of creative boundary to work to when using music, because there's so many options out there that finding an identity and a tone is what makes a soundtrack successful.
Yeah, I like all of the songs in the premiere are so great and so winky, like cheeky, ironic, because you have, I think you start with Love is the Drug. And
Yeah.
then you have You Don't Have to Say You Love Me by Dusty Springfield, and then Sweet Dreams of You. And then you close with Happy Together, which what I thought was just perfect. So how like, were any of those scripted or just some of
they weren't scripted. Actually, Love is the Drug, interestingly, even though it's our first song in the show, I think was our last song to agree on. So we tried lots, because it's really, you've got to set the tone with that opening scene. And we went through lots of different options. And I think that was, you know, the first episode is the first one to mix, but I think that was a conversation that was ongoing. And we tried lots of different things. And then actually Love is the Drug worked really well. And I think at first, what was quite interesting with the process on Baby Reindeer is we started off with a very small music budget. So when we started getting into the edit, you know, the ambition of how many songs we wanted didn't reflect what money we had, which is always my fun bit of the job is, okay, so how are we going to do this? And so we were kind of, you know, at first I was like feeding in kind of music that was less famous and, you know, that had the same vibe and maybe we could do this. And then there were a couple of key songs that we wanted to use, one of which was Happy Together by the Turtles for the ending, I think, of episode one. And also I Started a Joke, which is in episode six, by the Bee Gees. And they were kind of slightly, I think when you work on soundtracks, you always find those moments which really unlock how we're going to approach music and how featured the music is going to be. And, you know, actually this is going to be a commercial music heavy show. So those songs felt so important. My first thing was to actually get the rights and clear them, which I managed to do. The Bee Gees are very difficult to clear. So that was like, even if we spend every penny of the music budget on the Bee Gees, we will do that. But luckily Netflix saw what we were trying to do and went, okay, you can have some more money to support what you know, the vision. And that was so incredibly helpful because it meant then we could actually choose songs, you know, for the song itself, rather than trying to, you know, make things work and not cut corners, but, you know, find those cheaper options. We were able to use those more iconic songs and then balance that out with, the kind of the smaller artists and we managed to make it all work. Love is the Drug with Roxy Music was one that, yeah, was late going in. That was a tricky one, but so witty, and I think, you know, really, really worked in the end.
Mm-hmm. I also love the way that Happy Together is edited with the imagery, because it plays when he's on the computer reading up about Martha, and then he accepts her friend request, and then the show does a lot of pauses as well, like for his voiceover, but it pauses before it goes into like the big chorus with the credits. So it was like working with the edit to sync up the music like that.
Yeah, I mean, I cannot take credit for that idea of pausing that. That was the editor who put that together and had that pause in it. I think that song tonally is so interesting because there is a real kind of darkness to the verse and then this really euphoric chorus. And so it is an editorial dream because you can really change a scene and have those moments. And I think that was, that was a real kind of key moment on that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. Well, you're nominated for the fourth episode, which is, you know, a pivotal episode in the show. And we get Donnie's backstory. And we really, the music goes on the same kind of journey that he does, because it starts really optimistic when he's at Edinburgh Festival. And then you have I'll Come Running to Tie Your Shoe. And then the music kind of gets darker a little bit. So what was it like selecting songs for this episode?
Well, very much with that kind of journey in mind. The very difficult scenes, I think, in that, in terms of obviously getting rights and clearances through as well, with this episode, with, you know, very kind of the drug taking, sexual assault, is finding the right song that works for those scenes and deals with it delicately, emotionally, and I think, but also being able to kind of find something where the rights holders and where the artists were happy for us to use that. So we did investigate again quite a number of options for those. I think the key that we talked about in this episode is Donnie's loneliness and finding you know, his real inner voice, I think, in this episode. You know, it's really telling it from his story, from his side of the story. And you know, there's foreboding and things like Jethro Tull, teacher.
The perfect when Harry first gives him cocaine. I'm like, this is perfect.
And like the lyrics of that, I mean, it's quite an upbeat song, but it's about a teacher and somebody, you know, that's kind of too influential. And it's really interesting how you can find those songs that have those lyrics that are, you know, just match so many scenes in this. And then I think How to Fight Loneliness by Wilco, again, was we tried a lot of different options there, and actually we had a lot of no's, and then actually finding that song was so much better than anything that we tried to clear before, because it really just captures a kind of Donnie kind of just accepting it all, mm-hmm. as well, totally.
Yeah, that's during song. Like the when he's drugged out, like sort of that montage in the middle.
Yeah. So yeah, it was such a journey in this episode, and it was always the episode where, you know, we were all kind of waiting to see how we were going to approach it and what we were going to do. And then One by Harry Nilsson at the end again is, it's really interesting. I think a lot of music, we've used a lot of music from kind of the 60s and 70s, and there's a kind of upbeat positivity to a lot of these songs, but a real kind of melancholy in the lyric. And I think that's a pattern throughout a lot of what we've used, is kind of keeping the energy up and keeping that the music's used to kind of drive it forward, but really lyrically, like honing in on kind of Donnie's inner feelings, I think.
Yeah, that's the perfect closing song, I think, as well, because it's like about, you know, him explaining how he's just spurning all his dates and he's full of shame and anger, and you really get into his like inner turmoil with it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, a lot, you know, the special thing about Richard telling this story is that it's about him and it's about his trauma, but it's also focusing on Martha's trauma, and then nobody is to blame really in this, Darian aside, but there's, you know, it's really focusing on it's Donnie's behavior that is encouraging certain other behaviors. So a real kind of inner, he's really looking at himself from the outside in a way, and I think having lyrics and music that really really helps tell that, I think, has been a really, you know, a thing that we really wanted to do and support that.
Mm-hmm. Well, in the middle of the episode, Darian does this dance in front of Donnie when he's drugged out, and that's to Taffy Moradi, and it's really tribal and it feels so threatening. How did that come about, that selection?
So that one was, I didn't actually, I think somebody on set just found that as a bit of library music, just to do payback, as it happens, going, oh, we'll just, you know, we'll just use this later on, and just, you know, we're just going to want you to do this dance. So, and then it's a kind of weird piece where we go, okay, well, should we look at other options? But it's just so intense. It's just, I think it's one of those like kind of slight, you know, happy accidents where you're kind of temp track that you
it actually ends up working,
ends up and it's like, we need to have this, and it's like, I think, you know, I was like, well, let's try this, but actually there's something so threatening and kind of raw, and it's a great choice, and it's a real, a lot of people have said that is one of the most terrifying you know, kind of scenes that you know, people have seen. So it's a great use.
That's great. Were there any other songs that you had trouble clearing?
We had to write a few letters, or Richard had to write a few letters, where I won't say who to, just to kind of to kind of give a bit more context, and, you know, give a real personal kind of angle. I think it's when you clear music, you have to give as much information as you can on a scene, especially when it's controversial and the general context on a show. And I think, you know, I've worked on lots of shows where they're, you know, Killing Eve, for example, by the time we got to series two and series three, everybody knew what it was.
So I was like, here's my music.
I'll have my music in this, fine. Or, you know, whereas I think with this, the context of it, there was a lot of kind of people wanted to know more information. You know, we don't have really huge names. It's like it's an odd, you know, in it. And to actually see now, I'm sure everybody that's said yes has gone, oh, I'm glad that I did on that show. So, yeah, there were a number of kind of well-written letters that Richard and I collaborated on to try and talk some people into saying yes. And we did get some yeses from doing that as well.
Well, the final needle drop is Farewell Farewell by Fairport Convention. Also great and fitting, and also going back to what you were saying about the melancholy of it all, with that final scene too. So how did you land on that song?
Again, I think that was one that everybody, like, I think there were about four songs where everybody was like, I think this, you know, it was really important to Richard, I think, that we ended on that. He really, you know, felt very attached to that song. I think generally in the final episode, it was finding those optimistic, we kind of almost switched it from, you know, a slightly more optimistic songs tonally with melancholic lyrics to almost more, slightly more melancholic songs tonally that have more positive lyrics. So I think that's the kind of switch. So things like George Harrison, If Not For You, that, you know, that was in the same conversation of, you know, really, you know, telling a different side to the story. So that kind of flipped in the last episode. So that was kind of the kind of the angle for the end of the show.
Mm-hmm. Well, finally, what was your favorite song to use in the show?
Ooh, that's actually my favorite one is Come Wander With Me in episode 3, which we use. It's the song where Martha's been sat at the bus stop and she's been there for ages, and Donnie is kind of going, oh, you know, felt threatened by that. And then eventually kind of takes pity on her and feels sorry for her. And that song is actually from an episode of The Twilight Zone from 1968, and is super, like, it's so pure and so simple, but there's something about it that is really special. I actually tried to put it in an episode of Killing Eve and I couldn't get it cleared. So this was a kind of moment of going, come on, like, we can do it. And I managed to find a different contact and then it all went through and it was fine. And it was one of those things of going, I'm really actually pleased that we didn't use it on Killing Eve, because then we wouldn't have use it here. So but a real special song, and I think that moment is so it felt like a, you know, when you have those songs that are special but you're like, oh god, this is going to be tricky, it's really nice when you can unstick that and then they get used in the right way. And so that's my favorite
everything moment. Happens for a reason. See,
exactly.
Well, Catherine, it was great speaking with you. Thanks so much for your time, and congratulations again on everything, the show and the nomination. And have fun at the Emmys.
Oh, I will. Thank you so much. It's great to chat.